Oh, the one there.
One of them is someone's father, yes. Over here.
Poor Mrs.
Do we have a date on that?
Or is it still?
Good evening and welcome to the Webster Zoning Board of Appeals meeting for March 26, 2019. This evening we have two tabled items and four scheduled matters on the agenda. We do have proof of legal publication for each of this evening's scheduled items. The two tabled matters, one for 801 Ridge Road and one for 1074 to 1083 Glen Edith Drive, have requested postponement. John, there's no specific date for either of those?
Well, 801 Ridge Road, as soon as the board, as soon as the board would be able to hear them is April 23rd. It's not to say they won't be postponed again, but based on my reading of the project, they will be in very soon as the board will hear.
Okay, so I guess we'll just postpone until we hear from the applicant.
I would.
Yeah.
Want to set them both for April, is it April 23rd, the second meeting?
Glen Edith, I believe they'll be ready on the April 9th.
Okay. So, all in favor to table the application for 1074 to 1083 Glen Edith Drive to April 9th?
Aye.
Okay. And then all in favor to table 801 Ridge Road until April 23rd?
Aye.
Mr. Barone?
Here.
Mr. Denota?
Here.
Mr. Mounts?
Here.
Mr. Newtown?
Here.
Mrs. Volo?
Here.
Mr. Sacron?
Here.
Mr. Hauser?
Here.
If you could rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
To the first scheduled item, 707 DeWitt Road.
707 DeWitt Road, Webster, New York. Application for an area variance at 707 DeWitt Road, Webster, New York to permit license or approve the placement of a proposed 6-foot tall fence at the front setback, where such placement is not permitted pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-77B. By applicant Keegan Catalano of 707 DeWitt Road, Webster, New York, 14580.
Good evening, I am Keegan Catalano. I own it. I've owned it for just over a year. It's pretty straightforward. I'm trying to put a 6-foot tall, pressure treated wood privacy fence along it. And since I live on a corner lot, I have the luxury of two front setbacks, so that limits what I could do without a variance.
Even with the front setback on Woodruff, at 24 foot 8 inches.
Yes. It's probably going to be a little bit more back. After talking to him, I took a lot of trees out, and there's a lot of root balls, so I'm probably not going to be, so I'm going to be even further back from that now after discovering that last week.
And your note says it's to keep your dogs in, so I'm assuming that they, this is reason for the 6 foot tall fence is because
yes,
they can jump.
Yes, he would jump a 4 footer with a smile on his face.
Is that shut existing?
No.
What's that gone? The shut on gone?
That's not even on my, that was on my property when I bought it.
How far back did you say? You're going to go back further than?
Off this front, it's probably going to be closer to 30 foot now.
Off the front?
Yes. Off of Woodruff.
And you're measuring that from where?
Right from the woodrow. Right from the edge, where the grass line. I'm going to go 30 foot back.
So you're going back from the edge of pavement?
Yes. Yes.
I assume it's 24.8 based on what it's showing the house.
This is a, one of the older roads, so we would need to have the actual measurements for that to occur.
Let me ask you this. You're allowed 10 feet off the other line. Would you push the whole thing back to 10? Now it's 14.9. In other words, move the whole structure back so that you get further off the road?
I could come in wherever you want me to. That's a big fence. As I come in, I save money, so I'm completely open to
not saying that much.
It's quite a project.
Yeah.
What is the front setback here right now?
The house setback is 24.8 feet. The street line and the lot line, which look like they.
Yes.
Right, but what is the front setback in this
street?
Is it 50?
I'm speaking to the gentleman.
He'd like to line it up at the southwest corner of the garage at 24.8 feet.
Yes.
It would be best case, yes.
Isn't that where it's shown?
No, that's basically where it's shown. Just that we didn't have an actual measurement when the application was made.
Okay.
That's why we didn't advertise it for a specific dimension. Didn't want to assume.
And even in that location, it's still behind the profile of the house. It doesn't mm-hmm. block traffic. Line of sight from either DeWitt or Woodruff.
What happens if you put it at 40, which is basically halfway on the garage?
You lose a lot of the backyard?
40 feet would take him. Approximately 5 feet from the back end of the garage.
What's the purpose of the fence? Just for the dogs?
For dogs and for, it's going to be little kids too. Just because I have family that's also little, be cool. That's a cut across streets, all the homes behind me. And I found that out after I bought it. It sees some traffic. So it's also, it's just to contain an animal or a child, nothing more.
And it's a long but narrow lot. It's deep along Woodruff, but 100 feet, it's not terribly wide.
And if it were not a corner lot, the fence would be, when we discuss this.
I guess, you know, I think one of our functions here is to, you know, when we discuss is to minimize variances. In other words, we're not necessarily against this particular variance that remains to be seen, but my thought is, if you go back toward your north line, 4.9 feet, you'll still be within code, you'll be 10 feet. I'd rather see the front, the fence toward the road back a little bit. I don't know if you follow my logic here. That could be moved back, still be legal, you know, according to zoning on the, on that, that sideline, and push that back. It's, my only thought here is that's gonna be a long 6-foot fence right along the road, which, you know, if it's back a little further, I think it would just be a little more attractive, that's all.
So you're suggesting 4.9 feet to the north?
Yes.
Move it back, you'll have to have a little jog back to the house on the corner where it says 25.1 and 24.3 on the house, right? To move back 4.9, he's gonna have to return that fence back to the house. And then if we got another 4 feet on the front, then it'd be 30 feet where 40 feet would be required.
It's a little less of a variance. It is a narrow lot, so I understand the request, the need for that. But it's not really, you're not gonna lose space within that fence if you do that.
4 foot, moving it 4 foot, would you north? That's not
much. You move 4.9 to the north, would you agree to 30-foot front setback? It's like 1 foot difference on the other side.
30 foot off edge of road?
30 foot
from
front
setback.
From the front setback, I'm sorry. Yes.
Yeah, so that makes the less, you know, a less of a variance because instead of 40 feet, it's 30, so
yes.
To 25.
Okay, this meeting is open. Anyone wishing to speak for or against this application? Seeing no one, we'll return the discussion back to the board. Pursuant to NYCRR Section 617 in the Environmental Code, I'll make a motion for Type 2 seeker.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So the applicant has agreed to amend his application to a 30-foot setback on the, to a 30-foot front setback where 40 feet essentially will be required since this is in the front setback. The variance request would still be for a fence in the front setback. Once again, to reiterate, it would be 30 feet where 40 feet would put in the
requirement.
A couple of findings of fact that we noted. This is a corner lot. The applicant has said that this is a bit of a busy intersection, crossroad. Not a lot of space in the backyard where the house structure is set to the northeast. It's 14.9 feet off the rear setback. A majority of the usable lawn space is to the west, which is where the applicant is proposing to be found. See, there are no adverse environmental impacts. This is self-created, but he has worked with the board to lessen the overall impact on the variance request. Anybody have anything else to add?
Can I show the gentleman where it's going to be really in relationship to his...
Well, we're not changing our minds, so...
No, I understand. I just don't want him to start measuring out in the field of what Jesus is where I didn't measure.
Are you able to talk?
Yeah. Don't say that.
No.
I'll
make a motion to approve an area variance at 707 DeWitt Road, Webster, New York, to allow the placement of a proposed 6-foot tall fence in the front setback at 30 feet, where 40 feet would alleviate the request for variance, where such placement is not permitted pursuant to Webster Town Code 225-77B by Keegan Catalan.
Sir.
Okay, Mr. Newsom.
Aye.
Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Mr. Denodo.
Aye.
Mr. Mouse.
Aye.
Mrs. Bowler.
Aye.
Okay, you have your variance. Couple conditions apply. Must obtain all necessary governmental permits, including a fence permit. 1 year meaningful construction is set to expire 1 year from the season. Okay. Good luck. Thank you.
Thanks. 16120 Tarek Webster, New York. Application for an area variance at 1161 Twin Leaf Terrace, Western New York, to permit license or approve a proposed 14-foot by 10-foot sunroom and existing 10-foot by 12-foot deck with a 15-foot setback or 20 feet is required pursuant to resolution number 02-107 by applicant Ms. Judy Saper, represented by Patio Enclosures Maintaining Offices at 123 Dustage Drive, East Rochester, New York, 14445.
Philip Hart, 123 Dustbash Drive, acting as the agent for Judith Soper. She has an existing deck, and we're proposing to enclose approximately two-thirds of that deck. The situation that brought us here is the setback requirement for a deck is different from a sunroom. So as soon as we proposed to enclose the area, the deck was basically pre-existing non-conforming.
What's resolution 02107?
What was that?
I was speaking to Mr. Yes. Do you know what that is?
This was a 281. Also, the planning board established a rear setback for that development when they approved that development. And that's why you see that lot being a lot smaller than size. And the deck does exist. There was a building permit issued for the deck, but it should have received a variance even back then.
Yeah. We're maintaining the outline of the deck. We're not expanding it. We're just working with what's there.
And it will be the upper deck section, the lower patio will remain open?
Yes.
Okay.
So the existing setback for the deck is 15 feet?
Yes.
Open to anyone wishing to speak for or against this application. Seeing no one, we'll return the discussion back to the board. Pursuant to NYCRR section 617 in the environmental code, I'll make a motion to protect to seeker.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any other questions or comments?
No, it's just it's an incredibly shallow lot, 135 feet deep, and the house is almost 60 feet deep. As you can see, the house is right up against the front setback. The patio homes are front to back designs. When you look at the plan and look at the setback, she can't even have any porch in the back without variance. So I think it's a function of the geometry of that lot, the dimensions of that lot that require that they push this variance. There's another home directly behind?
No, it's open space behind them.
Okay. Is it deeded to the town of Webster?
Yes.
Oh, well, that helps.
Right.
Okay. So there's no neighbor to the rear that is going in?
No, there's not.
I know when going through the subdivision, there were a couple other
sunrooms that I had seen, that also had a south-facing house. I'm sure you can't go in the sunroom without having some cover over it. It's a short sun season that you do have.
Now, this is built in such a fashion that it really isn't designed to be heated in the future?
No, it's just an extended season room.
That's what it looks like. I just had to ask. I don't see any, as the applicant states, there's no neighbor to the rear that would impact. So there's really no detriment to the neighbors, the environment, so on. No views of lot. It's, you know, we could say anything's self-created, but the shape of the lot, it's wider than deep. The shape of the lot really is a driving factor in requiring this variance. But I don't see any negatives.
I think the only other thing that I would add, and you brought it up already, was that this is pre-existing. It's been there for how many years?
Tape map says 2005. So.
So it's been there for 13 years. 14 years, or right?
10 years.
Yeah, without any of that.
It's,
so it's not going any further into the setback.
It's remaining within the existing footprint that part of it. I don't care to make more.
Yeah.
Oh, did I do see?
Yes. I'll make a motion. To approve of area variance at 1161 Twin Leaf Terrace, Webster, New York, to permit license or approve a 14 by 10 sunroom, an existing 10 by 12 deck with 15 foot setback where 20 feet is required pursuant to resolution 2-107 by applicant Ms. Judith Saper, represented by patio enclosures, maintain offices at 123 Dispatch Drive, East Rochester, New York.
Second. Mr. DeNoto?
Aye.
Mrs. Bolo?
Aye.
Mr. Mounts?
Aye.
Mr. Barone?
Aye.
Mr. Newton?
Aye. Couple conditions apply. Must obtain all necessary governmental permits, including a town building permit, and 1 year meaningful construction is set to expire 1 year from the season.
Inspiration Point, Webster, New York. Application for an area variance at 241 Inspiration Point, Webster, New York, to permit license or approve a proposed 12-foot by 14-foot house addition with a 12 by 12-foot deck with a 6.4-foot side setback where 15 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-11, sub 5, sub 1, by applicant Brian Bohannon, 241 Inspiration Point, Webster, New York, 14587.
Can we tell you not to come back anymore?
He gave me 1 year. It hasn't been a year yet. Yes, I was here last year. I'm Brian Bohannon. 241 Inspiration Point. I got a variance for a deck last year. It gave us a year to have meaningful construction, and over the winter I really wanted to upgrade to an addition and a deck. It's on the same footprint, the 12 by 26 footprint of the deck, which is the second to last page of your packet, the survey map that says proposed deck. It's on that setback. If you look at the last survey map, the last page, that is the proposed addition. Just doesn't show a 12 by 12 deck off the back of it.
You want to keep the deck though, or you're going to still do the deck in that addition?
Yeah, I want an addition and deck.
So the variance we gave last time will still be effective for the deck.
Oh, okay.
The deck.
Mm-hmm.
So is the addition going under the deck?
No, if you look at the picture of the house, the second page, on the right of the photo, the addition would meet the back of the house there.
Okay.
And then the deck would be further back on that. Now, I was going to ask if I have the money. I wanted to possibly make the deck go west there over that concrete patio, which it doesn't look like would change anything about the setbacks, but if you look at the survey map, you can see the concrete patio.
That's not effective. That wouldn't be effective.
Would it be okay to...
Because that's plenty far off that setback line.
Okay.
When you go in that direction. How about, the rear setback?
So
this rear setback would come into effect, and then if the deck was extended westerly behind the house, rear setback.
What's the required rear setback?
It's whatever the board granted last year.
That's true, because that's back further than the house.
Right, it's in the house that's at an angle.
I'm wrong. That would be required. Not side setback, rear setback.
The comment you made earlier, just so I understand, the addition that you want to put on the house would actually bring it out even with the existing...
The old part of the house,
line, yeah. And then the deck would be off of that, but still within the parameters and the setbacks that we set in the previous variance?
Correct. It's the exact same footprint.
Okay, so instead of it all being deck, you're going to have an addition and deck.
Correct. I've given Barry a semi-model of the home. That's an old, old model of a variance that was asked for by Susan Holmes, who was a previous owner. If you look at that model and you take the addition to the very back of the house and then the deck off of that, it's almost identical to what I plan to build. I just wanted to bring the addition right to the back of the existing house.
June 12th of last year, the board granted a 2-foot side setback approval and then a 35-foot rear setback approval for the deck.
If it's staying within the footprints that we've already granted, do we have to grab another?
Well, if he extends it to the west as it was planned,
it
would need a rear setback variance, unless he maintained a 35-foot rear setback. And he would be in compliance.
So we didn't advertise for the rear setback.
We only have what was approved.
That's right.
Last June.
So.
Well, Brian was speaking hypothetically. He extended the deck to the west. Well, okay. That thing's very parallel. He would encroach on a 35-foot rear setback, which we granted last year. Okay. If he constructed it and not keep the deck parallel, as long as he maintained a 35-foot rear setback,
right,
he's good
right.
To go.
I hear you.
Okay.
But if you're going to encroach on that rear setback, you have to advertise properly for whatever you intend to encroach on.
It looks like it will encroach because it's 37 feet there to the corner, so it's got to be 30 or less to the corner of that concrete patio. So what would that require?
You have to submit a new variance request so that you can advertise it appropriately.
Okay.
No, you're staying parallel with your rear line with that line.
That would be angled towards the house.
That's correct, yeah.
It's your option now, you know which way to go.
Okay.
What's your option?
So if I build a larger deck, propose a new variance. Submit another letter for new variance.
Okay.
I have questions.
See you next year.
I'm leaning towards my letter of intent says an addition with a finished basement. I'm actually leaning towards a sunroom with no basement to save money to be able to build the big deck. Does it make any difference if that addition footprint is a sunroom or a heated living space?
No.
It would be the same. dimensions.
Now, that lot drops off significantly on that side. You pull the shot to put full basement on it. I mean, you got to have a combination wall of frost anyways.
The deck will be...
It would just make economic sense to put a full basement and make it a room.
It's a lot more expensive. I think I could live with a sunroom and a three-season room and...
So if you're talking sunroom, you can put it up on 4x4s or 6x6s?
Yeah.
Oh, so you can see right under.
Correct.
That's what we're talking about.
I have a question about assessments. I'm assuming that a heated addition of living space would add to my assessment?
It's going to go on that 100%.
Not at all?
Not at all.
To your knowledge, is that to be expected?
Any improvement will be assessed differently.
Okay.
So do you want to move forward with your variances request, or do you want to table it and come back with the deck as you're thinking?
I'd like to do this, and then can I come back again in the spring? And
next spring, yeah.
Oh, you can't do that.
You can't build it this spring?
Of course you can.
Are you strongly thinking about it?
Yeah, it's always about money.
It's going to be a separate, right. Okay, so it's about money. It's going to be another separate application, and you're going to have to pay for that process, too.
That's okay.
Or you can table this and combine it together and come to the next meeting if that's what you're proposing to do.
How soon do you think you would start? I don't mind just getting this approved.
By the meeting.
And then, he might be booked up another month or two or start sooner, so I'm on vacation for some of April, so
okay.
I'd rather just get this approved and then I'll submit a separate letter.
So essentially what's happening here is we previously approved the deck in June 2018, having a 2-foot side setback and 35-foot rear setback. He's gonna take half of that deck space for which we granted that variance and construct the 3-season room on top of it. So the setback request of the side setback request of 6.4 feet is based on the angle of the proposed deck off of the setback at that space where that addition is going to land.
Everybody's fine?
Yeah. Okay. This meeting is open. Anyone wishing to speak for or against this application? Seeing no one, return the discussion back to the board. Pursuant to NYCRR section 617 of the Environmental Code, I'll make a motion for type 2 seeker.
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
I don't see where that addition he proposes is any more intrusive than it actually get closer to the line yet. In other words, the deck is still substantially closer than the corner of that room that he's proposing. So I don't see where it's going to create any negative impact.
Well, it's the same thing we granted before, it's just a different measurement because that's where that point of the structure now exists.
So
essentially, there's nothing. He's just constructing in a closed room where it was previously attached.
And then, the only one that affects is the neighbor to the east, and here with Jeff, they're the only people that it's a strange lot, and they had the house twisted. You did get rid of the shed.
The shed is gone,
right.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I just picked this map because it had the deck and the addition on it. Yeah, the shed is gone.
That was one of our conditions of life.
Yeah.
I don't see any negative. It's almost identical to what he was asking for before.
Yeah, we're not changing any of the setbacks.
The inches are the same.
It's just enclosing half of what was open.
Okay, anyone care to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to grant area variance at 241 Inspiration Point, Webster, New York, to permit a proposed 12-foot by 14-foot house addition with a 12-foot by 12-foot deck. The house addition will have a 6.4-foot side setback where 15 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-11D 5 sub D sub 1. Now, I just would reiterate that. Now, has it been more than a year since you got the deck?
No, it was June of last year.
Okay, so you're gonna tackle this pretty quick. That's not gonna expire. or do you want to ask for an extension on the deck? Is it going to take longer than that to get the deck built?
I think I had till July, a year of
July. A full year to start meaningful construction.
Start before July?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so there's no need for us to modify the previous permits or extend it.
Well, this is a new application, so meaningful construction is on that order, essentially it's given a year.
Yes.
Or a year from now?
That's also going to start in the next couple months.
Right, but he's not bound by the previous 1 year commitment. He's getting it as a new application. Now, I would argue that the deck portion of it, at the 2 foot setback, would be bound by the 1 year meaningful construction set to expire.
But if he starts the room, just say it.
Right, I'm just saying.
Just start it.
By legalese.
Just start it.
We're not going to walk until.
Start it soon.
Ready?
Second, sorry.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Mrs. Bolo?
Aye.
Mr. Mounts?
Aye.
Mr. Denoto?
Aye.
Mr. Newtown?
Aye. Okay, couple conditions apply unless the panel must start governmental permits, including the building permit for the building addition. And 1 year meaningful construction is set to expire 1 year from EC. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Say that
model. Greetings. Sorry, I put through a model like that, so I need to do what I have.
Deck for Olive Drive, Webster, New York. Application for 5 area variances at 1100 Frawley Drive, Webster, New York. Will permit license or approve a shed in a 30-foot-by-30-foot pole barn construction, seeking the following relief for each structure respectively. Number one, for the shed, application for an area variance to permit license or approve a proposed shed in a 0.0 foot rear setback for 15 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-43. Two, pole barn, application for 4 area variances to license, permit, or approve. A, proposed 1,200 square foot pole barn where 462 square feet is permitted pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-36, subbasin 3. B, the proposed pole barn will be located in front of the rear of the principal dwelling where such location is not permitted pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-36, subbasin 2. C, the proposed pole barn having a 10.0-foot side setback where 15 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-11B, sub 5, sub 3. Sub 1, and D, proposed pole barn to have a 30-foot rear setback where 50 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code Section 225-11, sub D, sub 5, sub C, by applicant Patrick G. Fidelli of 1100 Frawley Drive, Webster, New York, 14580.
So
what
do you got at that?
Good evening. My name is Patrick Fidelli, and I reside over at 1100 Frawley Drive in Webster. I'm requesting appropriate variances to construct a 30-by-40-foot accessory building. The reason behind the structure is to make the neighborhood look more aesthetically pleasing. I'm the current fire chief for the Webster Fire Department and the chief paramedic for Northeast Quadrant Advanced Life Support, both of which provide emergency services to the town. I have 2 vehicles that have been issued to me by these agencies, and it is a requirement based on my position to be in possession of them. Due to the nature of the industry, we never know when an emergency will occur, and it is helpful to have these vehicles kept indoors in a climate-controlled atmosphere and prepared to respond. In addition to these two vehicles, we have two cars and a pickup truck that are parked in the driveway. And I have pictures of all that that I presented to all of you. I also have a third car in the current garage. During three seasons of the year, there's also a 33-foot boat parked in the driveway. I do not feel this is a good first look for anyone that is pulling into the track, and I'm here requesting authorization to build an accessory building. I initially wanted a 30-by-48-foot structure, but I found out that there was an issue with a 15-foot easement for drainage for the town that comes through the rear of my property, and therefore I needed to reduce the size of the accessory building. Due to this issue, I'm requesting to have the current 10-by-12-foot shed relocated to the backyard, which allows an additional 120-foot of additional storage. I believe this is the only place to build the accessory building because my property is a corner lot. The house was built to the south end of the property line and not center. Doing this would avoid a secondary curb cut. The cosmetics of the accessory building would match the color scheme of the house, siding, and the roof. There would be two windows per side, with the exception of the front, which will have two bay doors with windows and a man door also with a half door, half windows. The north side would have an additional 7-foot roll-up door and an additional man door, which would also have windows on it. There would be landscaping around the structure to give it a clean look. You'll note in the packets that I've provided this evening that I've obtained letters of support from all the surrounding neighbors that are directly involved in the construction of this building. You will also note that at 1104 Frawley Drive, those residents are actually renting that property. They are not the actual homeowner. For the 5 points of variance, I don't believe these variances are substantial in relation to the requirements set forth in the zoning ordinance because it falls within the parameters of having less than 2% of the total property size. I do not believe an undesirable change will occur by adding the structure because it will create an aesthetically pleasing look by removing all the registered vehicles out of view. The structure will be placed in the rear portion of the property at the end of the driveway going towards the tree line that will all the trees will be blooming in the spring, hiding the majority of the structure from my neighbor to the east, who is most affected. I do not believe there is an alternative method to achieve the outcome I am looking for, other than requesting a variance due to the design of the original structure, because it was built with a side-loading garage, therefore eliminating the option of an addition on the existing garage. Was this self-created? Yes, in part. I did create part of the problem by volunteering to become the volunteer fire chief, which added an additional vehicle to the fleet. But as far as the other issue emergency vehicle, that falls under my profession. Being on call with this unit is part of my job description. So I will take some of the blame. This accessory building will not have an adverse effect or impact on the physical environment conditions of the neighborhood because the design will incorporate standard building practices and the drainage will be mitigated by best engineering solutions. The one thing that I did note is that the first thing that is listed on there about the shed on these being at 0 feet, it's actually, I believe, 20 feet off the property line. Hope I answered all your questions and points of interest. Please let me know what you have for me.
That will be
20
feet in from the lot line and
completely
out of the
drainage. Correct. It will actually line up to the back of where the requested accessory building would end. It would be in that same line, straight across the back there.
When I scaled that, I thought it to be in the easement, so there's a little bus from one drawing to the other. So I look at worst case scenario, discuss it. This one to comply with the 20 feet, there's no need for a variance for the shed.
So we only have worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario. This way we wouldn't have to rehear it.
Right, right.
Explain again why the pole barn has to be so large. Explain the dimensions.
Yeah, so it's 30 feet wide, 40 feet in depth, and with the boat, that's 33 feet in length, so that'll just fit inside of that pole barn, so that's where the actual length comes from, but also double stacking the vehicles with the pickup truck and the emergency vehicles. They're about 18 feet each, so that would bring you up to 36 feet.
Are you going to ask the same question to eliminate three of these variances and not have to deal with this? Go ahead.
Go ahead, show me you're going to do that.
Connect this to the existing garage and then you eliminate basically everything on there?
Yeah, that was one of the thoughts. The problem that I think I'm going to have is with the roof line lining up.
I thought you can do it. You wouldn't actually have to move the structure though. You can build a connection. You can build a connector between the house.
Right, I was there. You said like a walkway, a breezeway, basically, right?
Mm-hmm. As long as the structures are connected.
Yeah, I would be willing to do that.
If you did that, you'd eliminate A, you'd eliminate B, you'd still may need C, the side setback, and maybe the rear. You eliminate two of the four. Here's my concern, Jerry, it's the only one in the development, right? There's no other pole barn.
Yeah, I searched pretty hard.
And I completely understand what you're trying to do. I agree with that.
They deflated the inflatable one.
Come back up for a hot second.
I would just say if you could take a look before we granted this at the possible connectivity.
The answer is I'd be willing to do it. I'm sure we can do that without a problem.
I mean, we can table it and you can come back to it, but that's just my thought.
No, that was Plan B in the back of my head in the house. That's fine.
Because then it becomes more like almost like a carriage building to the, you know, connected to the.
To that very point, I was thinking the same thing. I understand exactly what you're trying to do, but at the same time, you're moving cars into the existing structure that aren't part of the volunteer work, right?
Sure.
So you have to move all these vehicles into the structure to make it so large. So if you actually can look into connecting it, like Jamie suggested, it makes a lot of these issues go away.
Well, that eliminates my question. Is if they're separated, a standard two-car garage width is 24 feet. I don't know if you can make it narrower to minimize the size impact, but by connecting it, it doesn't make it.
Right. Yeah, I would prefer to connect it.
I would say just table it and think about it.
No, that was already Plan B, so I figured I was going to have to adjust a little bit. I knew I was asking for a lot, so.
But we would still need
to still need the two. The rear side and the rear, but
sure.
At least that eliminates the other two.
Yeah, but they're not.
I don't know if this is broad purpose of the scale, but if you could slide it to the door where you connect it to the garage, you might eliminate that side setback.
Yeah, if it slides any further over, I think it's going to end up touching the other structure. So I would rather ask for the variance so that it's a 10-foot setback on the south side there and just put a breezeway in. Request that variance.
That would also eliminate your appearance in front of the planning board.
And all good answers.
It's up to you. We can table it.
No,
we can add
no,
these
go
around
with
one. Just those two.
Yeah, I'd like to keep moving forward on that.
Okay, so then A goes away because it's a connected addition.
That
goes away because it's connected. C and D are the only things we need to.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So can you just make a request to modify your application to eliminate the items A and B of the application? Just you got to make the statement, Jerry.
Yeah, hang on. I'll straighten it out. So I'm requesting to make a change and remove A and B of my application.
Okay. Which is the 1,200 square foot pole barn where 462 is required and the barn being located in the front of the rear of the rear most point of the principal dwelling.
Okay.
And the shed?
That's not an issue.
It's not an issue anymore.
So the shed's gone.
It's going to be 20 feet out.
So item number one is gone, and two, A and B are not on. This meeting is open to anyone wishing to speak for or against this application. Do you want to say anything, Reagan? No? Seeing no one, we'll return the discussion back to the board. Pursuant to NYCRR section 617 of the Environmental Code, I'll make a motion for type 2 seeker.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Or we can adopt what he said, minus the shed and A and B.
Yeah, the structure's a little bit out of character with the neighborhood because of its size. The applicant stated why he needs that size structure. But when you attach it to the house, Webster doesn't really have a limit on garage size with respect to the house size. Some towns do. Village does, of course, I got caught in that one. But, even though the size of the structure is out of character with the neighborhood, there's no zoning law against that. There's no environmental impacts. We have 11 signatures. I read through some of these.
Four signatures of the people directly impacted by the structure.
So as long as you're on that, let me just quickly read these. In favor, letters of support that will go on file are 1425 State Road, Gary Stampinato, 1104 Frawley Drive, Julie Walensky, 1441 State Road, Kevin Farrell, and 1432 State Road, Carmelo Moche.
So all the immediate neighbors signed a letter of support for the applicant. Self-created, you know, with the number of vehicles in his occupation as a volunteer fire chief. But there's no environmental issues. We have letter support from the neighbors. I guess, you know, if he could exit to the house and it's done in the proper fashion, there's really no issue. He's outside of the easements. The side setback is not really a huge issue. The 10-foot side setback is still substantial. The rear setback's a little tight. To me, that's the biggest variance that he's looking for. But again, the only way for him to accomplish the goals he's looking for is with a building that it's that deep. It's a corner lot, so that depth of that lot on that side is only 124 feet deep. A standard lot in Webster is 200 feet deep. That's a big difference. So if he had a deeper lot, that rear setback, of course, would be more substantial. Yeah, it's quite a bit of corner lots. We see a lot of more variances for corner lots than interior lots.
And part of it, I think, is due to the house placement on the lot because the house is biased.
I'll put that up.
Yeah, I don't know. Some of those things. It's biased to the southeast segment of the lot, which is really the only logical place. So, just by nature of the house placement, which gives it a nice wide sweeping yard, it necessitates impingement on the rear of the sides of the house.
Anybody else? All right, with that, I'd like to make a motion to grant area variances for a proposed pole barn with the understanding that this structure is going to be attached to the principal residence on the property.
I think we'd be better if we should probably not even call it here.
It should be a garage addition.
Garage extension.
Right, okay. So we're going to call this a garage extension. Having a 10-foot side setback where 15 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code section 225-11, sub B, sub 5, sub B, sub 1. And the proposed garage addition is to have a 30-foot rear setback where 50 feet is required pursuant to Webster Town Code section 225-11, sub B, sub 5, sub C by Patrick G. Fidelli. 1100 Crowley Drive, Webster, New York.
Okay, Mr. Barone.
Aye.
Mrs. Bolo.
Aye.
Mr. Mouse.
Aye.
Mr. Denoto.
Aye.
Mr. Nusio.
Aye. Okay, you've got your variances as requested. Couple conditions applied, must obtain all necessary government permits, including a town building permit, which you can apply for tomorrow, and 1 year meeting for construction is set to expire 1 year from this evening. Okay?
Thank you all.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes this evening's meeting. Thank you for watching.
I got a few sets of minutes.
Yeah, I wish you'd put the minutes in before you close it out. That'd be nice.
No, we do that after the meeting, so if you could please turn that on.
All right, do it.
Okay.